Steve Dotto, how the heck are you this fine day? Me? I am feeling somewhat trepidant. Why am I feeling somewhat trepidant? Because you and I are about to descend into the murky waters of Facebook privacy and security settings. You should be trepidant too. All right, let's take a little look at one aspect of Facebook's privacy and security. Now, I am not a huge fan of how Facebook communicates our options as far as protecting our privacy. Bottom line is, Facebook, I don't think they care one iota about protecting your privacy. They probably care about not being sued, but the less privacy that you have as far as Facebook is concerned is the more information that they have access to on you, which they convert into money. So they want you to have as little privacy as possible. At least that's my belief. They can argue with that should they choose. Consequently, I think they make it very difficult for us to understand exactly what is private and what's not within their environment. And the settings are confusing at best as far as setting things up. So before we dive in, I'll just give you one kind of overriding theory that I have, or overriding theme that I constantly harp on privacy settings on the internet. And it really is the same as far as security settings on the internet. When people ask me how secure an online service like a Dropbox or a Google Drive or any cloud-based service is, I have this standard saying, which is, the internet is 100% secure for anything which does not need to be secure. So we can say the same thing about privacy. Your privacy is protected on Facebook 100%. For anything which does not need to be private. See, regardless of how much you lock down any social network, anything you post on it, you have to consider to be fair game for anybody to see. So before you post anything at all, you have to think, even if you've got all your privacy settings locked down, you have to think anybody in the world will likely see this, including mom, your partner, your brother, your old teacher, or the government. Anybody will gain access to it if they really want to see it, or if you're just unlucky. So the best piece of advice we can give is just don't post anything that you're at all uneasy with. Now, having said that, going into Facebook's privacy settings here, and you do that by going onto the little triangle menu and clicking on settings, you will find a bewildering assortment of different settings here available to us. And you should take time and go through and read and understand what each and every one of these menu items represents. That's really your job. Facebook's not going to do it for you, and their default settings don't protect your privacy very much at all. But what I want to talk to you about today is the apps one. And the reason that the apps one is so interesting right now is Facebook has a reason to have a relationship with many different other services. There's a good reason that a relationship is formed. And a fairly popular method of streamlining our journey online these days is something called OAuth, which is an automatic online authorization that allows us to log into services using a different service's logon criteria. And you'll see it. You'll go to a service and it'll say, would you like to create a new user account, or do you want to log on using Google or Facebook? You'll see that often. And you probably wonder, which is better? Is it better to log on with, is it more secure? Now, I don't know which is more secure, but here's my take on it. If you're a really good password manager, if you use something like LastPass, which we've shown you in previous videos, and you use that religiously, so you've got nice encrypted passwords and you've got a good password strategy, I think you're better off creating unique accounts for each and every service that you log on to. It might take you a little bit longer to log on, but you're far more secure. If you're the sort of person who does what we tell you not to do, and you just have a single password, darn you, or you use the same password many, many times, then I think it's a great idea to use your Google or your Facebook account to log in, because that information is not being transferred. You're just being authorized through, and so your password is in less places and it's less likely to get stolen in that particular case or get compromised. So that's my take on it. It's not scientific. I don't know if the big experts in security agree with me or not, but that's the way I look at it from a pragmatic point of view. Now, the other question is, what apps should have access to our Facebook logon information, and what else are they asking for? See, for example, if I was in Hootsuite, which is a social media dashboard, which does things like I use it to do all my tweets, logging on to that with my Twitter account, which they allow, seems to me to be completely reasonable because the two have a symbiotic relationship. So understanding that relationship and then what you're giving authority to, that's an important part of the process that you have to educate yourself on. Because every time you use one of these services, that app will tell you in the confirmation screen what it's asking for access within Facebook. Some will ask you for the right to be able to post to Facebook on your behalf. Some will ask you to be able to look up your friends or your email address or other things within Facebook. So you have to determine whether or not that's justified or not as you authorize each app. And some of the apps which have more noble purpose, shall we say, there's good reason to give them access, and other ones maybe not such good reason. So this is where we now on a regular basis should go and take a look at what we've given access to and what we're using and what we're not using, and then remind ourselves of what access they have to our Facebook account. This is a really healthy exercise that you should do at least quarterly, I would say, because often when we're logging onto these services, we just kind of want to get in and see what they're doing. So we're not really thinking about what we're giving permission to. And I think in the back of our minds, we're thinking, I could always go back and correct this later, but we often don't go back later. So this is the later when we should go back and correct. So let's take a look at some of the things. For me, obviously, having access, allowing YouTube access is a natural since I publish videos like this. And as we go through, we see the different apps, and you see I've got a lot of apps that have access to my Facebook account here, or that I log on using Facebook that I have related. And some of them, if I click on, say, the Multiple Sclerosis Society of Canada, if I click on that, the reason that I installed their app is I do a MS walk. I go for a walk and I raise money. So Facebook is a great place to get people to sponsor and to raise money. So they're asking for my basic info, my email address, my birthday, my location, and they're also asking to be able to post on my behalf. Which means that, but they aren't posting without my permission, but they're within their app. I'm saying I can post this to Facebook, and then they're putting that post through. Those are all completely legitimate for this particular app. So I'm just going to leave things the way they are. Even though I'm not going to be using it for a couple of months because the next walk that I'm on is not till next year, I'm still going to leave that one active. But as I scroll down a little bit further, I see other apps that I don't use very much anymore. Well, I do use Songza a lot, but why has Songza got access to my Facebook account? What are they asking for? Well, they're actually not asking for much. It's mainly logon information. They're not asking to be able to post. So again, I'm probably going to say, okay, it seems fairly benign. And so I'm going to go through and I'm going to look at all of these different apps and see exactly what they ask for. 22 social instant access. I think that's like a social media dashboard that I don't use. And I can see here, last login is more than 6 months ago. It's not something that I'm using. So I'm just going to click here and say, remove the app. And now it's being taken off. If I need it again, I can go back to it. But obviously, I haven't used it in 6 months. It's not that important to me. So going through and filtering and cleaning it up is a really healthy exercise. Unfortunately, this is just one step of the things that you should be doing as far as protecting your privacy on Facebook. We could spend hours going through all of the different menu items within the privacy settings and trying to explain them to you. And then unfortunately, we'd probably have to make another video in 3 months because Facebook will have changed some of the things that in some of the ways they do things. But constantly visiting, going through the menu settings, making sure that you are comfortable with where your settings are, and at the same time understanding that regardless of how you set your settings, that you can't trust those settings to be 100% infallible. I think those are really healthy attitudes to take into Facebook, which does a good job then of protecting your privacy and not allowing something untoward to happen. I hope you found this useful, if somewhat depressing, perhaps. And if you have found it useful, I encourage you to become a part of the Dotto Tech community. Now, there's three ways that you can become part of our community. The first is become a subscriber to this YouTube channel. Then you'll know about all of our new videos as soon as they come down the pipe. Second is sign up for our newsletter. I send out emails about once a week, which include a digest of all of our videos and also notification of all of our upcoming live and special events, including webinars and live shows and that sort of stuff. So please sign up for the newsletter. And finally, Dotto Tech is supported by you, the community that watches our shows. And that is done through the Patreon site. It's a crowdfunding site that allows individuals to support us financially. for as little as a dollar a month, which works out to about 5 cents a video, you can become one of our Patreon supporters. There's perks that are attached that make things better for you, and you giving us money makes things better for me. So I consider that to be a win-win situation. I encourage you to visit our Patreon page. We explain it all there, and I just appreciate you taking a look. And I also appreciate you taking the time to learn with me today. I hope you found it valuable, as I said. And with that, I am done. I've got to go through this list, and it's going to take me a while. I'm Steve Dotto. Have fun storming the castle.